Hey guys, welcome back to another video. This is Troy from Cichlid Bros. In today's video, Alec and Quinn are going to join me as we walk through the pros and cons of the primary aquarium filtration methods. Hopefully by the end of this video, you pick up on some helpful tips when selecting your aquarium filtration for your next aquarium setup. Looking forward to discussing this one, so let's dive right in. Today we're going to discuss the four main types of aquarium filtration, which include sponge filters, hang-on-the-backs, canister filters, and sumps. We're going to outline the pros and cons of each type so that you can choose what's best for your tank setup. We're also going to give our own opinion on our favorite types of filters towards the end of the video. One other thing to keep in mind before we get into the different types of filters is just what your filter is there to do. It's obviously there to clean your water and make sure it's crystal clear, but it's also there to house beneficial bacteria to carry out the nitrogen cycle. When fish waste and food breaks down, it creates ammonia in your tank, which is toxic, and that beneficial bacteria will break it into nitrite, which is then further broken down into nitrate, which is far less toxic to your fish. And at that point, you can do water changes to keep your nitrate levels low, or you could have a lot of live plants in your tank, which consume some of those nitrates. So some of the terms we're going to use in the video include mechanical filtration, which is a lot of your sponges or your filter floss, and this keeps your tank looking crystal clear, pulling out a lot of the debris and particles that are floating in your tank. And then your biological filtration, which comes in many different forms, including your bio rings, your bio balls, bio blocks. There are many different types that can go in this category. The one thing these biological filtration options have in common is that they're usually very porous with plenty of surface area for the beneficial bacteria to grow. And just a reminder, the beneficial bacteria will grow on all surfaces in your aquarium. It's not really in the water column. So if your filter has sufficient mechanical and biological filtration, it will keep your tank looking crystal clear. And the biological filtration will make sure your nitrogen cycle is happening in your tank and that no ammonia or nitrite is present. The last type of filtration media is chemical, and this is optional, but a lot of people like to go with it to make sure their water is crystal clear. It's really that cherry on top of everything else you do to keep your water looking clear. A few examples of this are charcoal bags or ChemiPure or Seachem Purigen. All of these are very good options if you're looking for chemical filtration. I personally go with ChemiPure Blue or ChemiPure Green, as they do a really good job at making sure your water is crystal clear. Okay, with all that being said, I'm gonna pass it over to Alec to talk about our first filtration option, the sponge filter.
Sponge filters come in a few shapes and sizes, but it's the simplest form of filtration out there. The sponge filter provides plenty of mechanical filtration with the sponge, and it has enough surface area to provide biological filtration as well. All you need is the sponge filter, airline tubing, and an air pump, and you're good to go. For the pros on the sponge filter, one is they are cost effective. Even a big sponge filter would only run about 10 bucks. If you already have an air pump, it could run multiple sponge filters at a time. Another pro would be for any fish room, you could have one big air pump running many sponge filters, which provides the filtration without needing an extra plug in per filter. Another positive is that they're great for tanks with fry or quarantine. You won't be at risk of sucking up babies, shrimp, or snails with a sponge filter. You can also run a sponge filter in an existing tank and easily pull it out for a new tank setup to cycle that tank almost immediately. Lastly, sponge filters are super easy to clean. Just pull them out and wring the sponge out and you're good to go. The sponge filter does have some cons as well though. The biggest one for me is the aesthetic of the tank. If I have a display aquarium, I don't want to see a big bulky sponge filter as part of my aquascape. You can hide them behind decor to a certain extent, but it's just not the cleanest look. Also, larger tanks may require multiple sponge filters, which could take up a lot of real estate in the tank and clutter things considerably. And although the air bubbles are great for creating surface agitation and oxygenating your water, the aesthetic of the bubbles is something I'm not really a fan of. There are some internal filters that will be comparable to the sponge filter, and although they can do a good job, they do take up some real estate in the tank.
Hang-on-the-back filters are maybe the most common of all filter types, and they can be great for a few reasons. Because they hang on the back of the tank, they don't take up room inside the aquarium like an internal filter might. They might cost a bit more than sponge filters, but usually their cost is pretty effective. They also have a lot of room to customize media types. You could fit a lot of biological or chemical filtration in most hang-on-the-back filters that you wouldn't have with the sponge filter. You could put bags of bio rings, matrix, bio balls, it's really up to you. I also like to use Kimmy Pure in my tanks, which can help keep my water crystal clear. And Hang On The Backs usually have plenty of room to include these add-ons. Hang On The Backs can also oxygenate your tank by breaking the surface tension when the water is returning to the tank. These filters come in many different types and sizes to fit your needs. And if you get a good brand, they can be pretty quiet. The Seachem Titles are a really quiet option because their pump is in the water. So that hum you might get with some Hang On The Backs isn't there as much. But usually the noise for Hang On The Backs is not too bad.
One benefit to Hang On The Back filtration is that they're usually really easy to clean. All you need to do is unplug it, remove the lid, and pull out the media tray, and it's really easy to clean in that way. And just one tip, if you're throwing away cartridges that come with your Hang On The Back filters each time you clean it, a great way to save money and preserve your beneficial bacteria is to replace those with sponges and biomedia that can be rinsed off and reused. A few cons of the Hang On The Back is that you need to have space behind your tank or on the side to fit it, so you'll need to plan that out. Sometimes that can be a problem if you can't have your tank a little bit off the wall. Another thing to consider is just the aesthetic of the Hang On The Back filter. I don't totally love the bulky box on the rim of my tank, especially for a big, nice display tank, so sometimes I avoid Hang On The Backs for this reason. Some brands have decent options in this regard, and again, I really like the title here, but for a lot of my tanks, especially the big ones, I usually go with a canister or a sump over the Hang On The Back. So canister filters have some really clear pros and cons to them, so it really depends on what your preferences are to determine if this filter is right for you. I really like canisters because they can be stored under or to the side of your tank, being out of sight. On my 180-gallon tank, you can hardly see the intake and outtake going over the rim of the tank. When the canister is under the tank, it can really dull out any sound, hum, or vibrations, which can make it one of the best options when it comes to noise. This was a primary reason we went with the canister filters on Billy Donovan's tank install, as the tank was in his office and living space where we didn't want any trickling noise from a Hang On The Back or from a sump. Canister filters are also really nice because you don't need a ton of space between the tank and the wall to have the hoses feed down into the filters.
Canisters can also hold a ton of filtration media, which can all be customized. Most trays come with sponges, different types of biomedia, and if you want, space to add chemical as well. Out of the filter types discussed so far, canisters will most likely hold more media and water volume than any other type. Canisters can also be customized for nano or nicely aquascaped tanks with things like lily pipes to give an even better aesthetic to the tank. Now let's talk about a few negatives of the canister. First of all, it's likely going to be more expensive than sponge or Hang On The Back filters. Many of the canisters will be over $100, with some of the larger filters like the FX6 or Oase's running you over $300. However, I find them to be worth the money in most cases. And maybe the worst aspect of the canister filter is the maintenance. The one thing I dread doing when it comes to upkeep is cleaning the canisters. In most cases, you have to disconnect the hose and get a bit of water on you. Then you have a heavy canister you have to lug over to a tub or a sink. There are some canisters with new features that allow you to drain the water first or remove the media basket without carrying the full canister, but in most cases, you're going to have a heavy and dirty canister filter.
It's also difficult to know when the canister needs cleaning because you can't see how dirty it is from the outside. So you need to switch up different cadences on cleaning your canister to see what works best for your tank. But cost and cleaning aside, the canister filter has some really good aspects as well. I usually think these outweigh the cons, and because of this, we run a lot of canisters on our aquariums. I also like to keep my canister with another filter, like a Hang On The Back filter, just for redundancy. If one of my filters would ever go out, or if I just forgot to plug one in after a water change, the other filter would get by. Especially as a teacher in my classroom, I'm not here during the weekend, so I really like to have that fail safe. But there's one last filter type to talk about, and that is the sump.
Some hobbyists will say the sump is king when it comes to aquarium filtration, but there are some things to keep in mind when it comes to the sump, both positive and negative. Starting with the pros, sumps are usually hidden out of sight, either under your tank or plumbed into a different room. They can hold a ton of equipment such as heaters, ATOs, skimmers, and reactors. This makes it extra beneficial for saltwater tanks that may have some extra equipment that is best fit into a sump. Being able to hide things such as your heaters down in the sump is a huge plus.
Sometimes you may not even realize how much of an eyesore some of your equipment in your tank can be, until you don't have it in there any longer. I love how clean my 150 gallon tank looks with the sump, whereas my 180 has the heaters visible and I totally notice them now. Sumps can also add a lot of water volume to your tank. Using my 150 as an example here, the seamless sump here holds about 50 or so gallons of water, which can help dilute any toxins in the tank, and with more water volume, there are less drastic swings to your water parameters. This can also help with evaporation. I have this water reservoir which keeps the water level consistent for weeks without needing any type of top off to the tank.
Because sumps can fit so much media, they're great for large tanks. Instead of using 3 to 4 canisters, for example, really it's just up to the individual fish keeper of what they prefer. Many people choose to make a DIY sump. Overall, sumps are a great option for the DIYer that wants to save some money.
There are a few negative aspects to sumps though, one of which is that you do need to have some type of knowledge when it comes to plumbing. For a beginner or someone new to plumbing a tank, it can be a bit overwhelming at first. I did a lot of research on this before setting up my saltwater tank and the sump that came with it about a year and a half ago. Since this was my first sump, I was very confused at times, but once I got the hang of it, I really enjoyed the sump and was proud of the plumbing job I had accomplished. Even with the seamless sump on my 150, I needed to cut the hosing, glue in bulkheads, and make sure all fittings were correct. You also need a drilled tank in most cases when going with a sump. Another issue some people may have with sumps is a draining or gurgling noise coming from the drain pipes. This can definitely be an issue if you don't have a controllable return pump or a gate valve on your primary drain. The gate valve lets you tune to the flow to make an airtight seal and reducing that gurgling noise. For my 150 gallon tank, I needed to turn down my Ceche return pump just a bit to avoid the suction noise that was very loud at first. Now the sump is fairly quiet and I have no real issues there. But overall, due to the added water volume, the ability to hide equipment, and customizable filter media and flexibility on how you want to set it up, the sump is a really good choice. I personally would go with a sump on any tank I set up in the future that's over 100 gallons or so, and especially if I set up a saltwater tank. So in summary, what is the best filter type? I think on display tanks, I would usually go with a canister or a sump, but if I had a fish room or breeding projects going on, I think I would probably go with sponge filters with maybe a hang on the back. I guess it just depends on your situation because each type of filter has pros and cons. So I hope you found this video helpful. It's already a long video and we can't get to everything when it comes to filtration. So if you have a comment or a question, definitely leave that down below. I'll also leave a link to the playlist down in the description below where we have many different unboxing and setups of different filters. I think it would be a really helpful resource if you're looking into setting up some of these different canisters and hang on the back filters. Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you on the next one.